Welcome to the First Unitarian Fellowship of Nanaimo. My name is Penny Bent, and I am the service leader for this morning. If this is your first time with us, a very special welcome to you. We invite you to visit our website for more detailed information about who we are, the services we offer, and how you can connect with us. Whatever your ethnicity, theological belief, gender, sexual orientation, age, and everything that makes you who you are, please know that you are warmly welcome in our community. We acknowledge today that we meet on the unceded traditional territory of the Shinto First Nation. As Unitarians, we commit to the work of reconciliation required to address the harm done to all Indigenous peoples and their cultures by non-Indigenous peoples. I would now like to move on to announcements. Thank you, Martha Costco, for the flowers you see this morning. To find out about all special events, groups and meetings taking place in the fellowship, go to the calendar on our website or open the weekly update email which you received on Thursday. And a reminder, this Thursday, the April the 22nd, is Earth Day. Let us now enter into sacred time. Leah, our musical director, will lead us into worship through music.
Thank you, Penny, and good morning, everyone. This morning's prelude was written by Pete Seeger, and it's in keeping with our theme of the month, being actively engaged, and particularly this morning as we celebrate our sacred home, the Earth. To my old brown earth and to my old blue sky, I'll now give these last few molecules of I. And you who sing and you who stand nearby, I do charge you not to guard well our human chain, watch well you keep it strong, as long as sun will shine. And this our home, keep pure and sweet and green, for now I'm yours, and you strong, as long as sun will shine. And this our home, keep pure and sweet and green, for now I'm yours and you.
For you are also mine. What a beautiful song, Leah. Thank you and Pete Seeger for writing it. Well, here we are. It's so good to see everyone again this morning. At least through my camera, I get to see all your smiling faces. It's summer. That's what I've been hearing all week. It's like we skip spring and we're deeply into summer. And I hear how everyone is out there enjoying the heat and out there walking. Of course, being restricted. Here we have the third wave coming in now. And we're finding our way through it. We're finding the things that we can do, that we enjoy doing. And a lot of it has to do with being with the people that we love in ways that we can, and being out in nature. And we are so fortunate to be in a part of the world where our nature is just so incredibly beautiful. So as Leah mentioned, we are recognizing the theme of the week, the month, which is actively engaged. We're linking it in with Earth Day coming up this week. And our service both today and next Sunday will focus on our beloved Earth. So with that in mind, our opening words are by Lynn Harris, and it's entitled Committed to Respond. Committed to respond to the call of a wounded world, we join together this day with loving hearts, hands, and minds, embracing the interconnected web of water, air, and earth. We light a fire of sustaining hope ever bright with love and justice. May we bring forth this day new wisdom, strength, and courage to create a new world, not of wealth, but well-being, a world of new peace and abundance for all. As we give thanks for this earth, our shared and singular home, may we dedicate ourselves to its ongoing care, rising to the calls deep within us and all around us. May we respond today and always with courage and with love.
As we light our flaming chalice, we pause and remember that we are formed by this earth. Her elements exist in us and in every living thing. From earth we are formed, and we return to earth with gratitude.
Our opening song this morning is We Are Not Our Own, and thank you to Ruth for putting our words up onto the screen.
Be a house of welcome, living
So our meditation this morning is what I think a very fascinating video about mycelium seen through the microscope of microbiologist Dr. Patrick Hickey. And he works in the area of infectious diseases and fungal genetics. The music was created by a chorus called Beautiful Chorus. Now, mycelium, if you don't know, is the vegetative part of a fungus, consisting of a mass of branching, thread-like hyphae. The mass of hyphae is sometimes called shiro, especially within the fairy ring fungi. Fungal colonies composed of mycelium are found in and around the soil. So the meditation video is called Brilliant Mycelium. Please take a deep breath now and relax your bodies and open to something quite beautiful. Brilliant Mycelium.
Are you listening? Can you feel us?
meditation song words I think are worth repeating. Go deeper. Have you vision? Are you listening? Can you feel us? Share our wisdom. We've heard a creative, imaginative expression of mushrooms singing to us. But could we, or could they, really communicate with us? And if they could we hear them? And if we could hear them and communicate with them, what would our relationship be like? So I'm wondering if you've ever imagined having a relationship with a mushroom, or a cedar tree, or a waterfall. Now, I've spoken before, and there are many books describing the interdependent and highly complex relationships between trees, their roots being communication systems that connect whole forests or groves. Slowly and with the help of curious scientists, the general public is being introduced to a complex world of communication, invisible to our eyes and inaudible to our ears. If the trees have a complex communication system, is it not possible that they also have the ability to communicate with humans, and we haven't figured out yet how to hear it? Or maybe we have simply lost the ability to hear him. I think that we modern human beings have advanced ourselves into an insulation from what has been a close and interdependent relationship with plants and animals, a relationship that some indigenous people still have. Have we lost what once was a normal and integrated relationship? I would suggest to you that we have gotten so far from this relationship that we cannot imagine it even being possible, let alone real. So I'm using the theme of actively engaged today as an opportunity to talk about how we might be more actively engaged with our natural environment. And on this Sunday, before Earth Day, I'm wondering if we might put our judgment aside and consider if this active engagement might include relationships with mushrooms and cedar trees and waterfalls. I was drawn to Finhorn in my early 20s. I caught the buzz of the excitement that went around the world about a place in the far northeast of Scotland on a windswept and barren dune that happened to sprout a miraculous garden. Unbelievably, unnaturally enormous vegetables were being grown in a trailer park garden, inhabited by three adults and three children living off unemployment benefits. Somehow, the adults had discovered how to communicate with the vegetables, and the vegetables themselves had told them what they needed the human beings to do in order for them to grow their very best. For years, Eileen, Peter, and Dorothy, who were the adults, had worked together, each with their own unique skill set, to develop relationships with what they called the divas of the vegetables. The diva were the consciousnesses of the species. So if we are talking about mushrooms or carrots, it's not the individual mushroom or carrot, but the collective of carrots that is the diva and is the spokesperson for all the carrots in the garden. You see how language is so human-centric. Of course, they aren't people. They are the spokes carrots, carrot. The divas communicated with Dorothy, and she would then tell Peter what they needed, and he would make it happen. Word spread locally about this strangely extraordinary garden. People started to come to investigate it for themselves. Were those rumors true? Apparently, they were. And as word got out, more people began to come from across Scotland and then England and then Europe, and eventually North America and the whole world arrived with their curiosity. Was it truly possible that humans and vegetables could communicate? What began as a family garden grew into an international village where people came from throughout the world to understand how it was possible to connect and communicate with nature spirits and plant divas. Today, nearly 60 years later, Findhorn has grown into a thriving village housing hundreds of people from all over the world and an internationally recognized spiritual learning center. It started with one person willing to open themselves to the possibility of a relationship with a vegetable. Remember the mycelium. Go deeper. Have you vision? Are you listening? Can you feel us? Share our wisdom. How many of you talk to houseplants? It's not uncommon, though we laugh it off as an indulgence or a silliness. But I see real relationships being built with our houseplants, where we actively engage, not just with their feeding, but with a reciprocal caring. In our house, we have three orchids in the living room that since their first flowering about a year and a half ago, they have done no growing. So recently, Theo, my partner, who is the orchid whisperer in our house, has taken over their care and they have responded. One now has four new flowers and the other two are both pushing out new stalks that we watch inch forward daily, more than daily, many times in the day. But what I want to tell you about is the relationship I see. Every morning, Theo starts his day by going to the orchids and picking each of them up and carefully looking under their leaves at the new growth, admiring them, delighting in each millimeter of growth, caring for their need with water, for light, and for changes in temperature. Isn't that what we do with our human relationships? Wouldn't we all bloom if another person paid that much attention to us, delighted in every tiny change? So why think it's silly to have a relationship with a plant or a vegetable? Is it that we think we are not equal? Is it that we think that they are incapable of communicating with us? Do we think that they cannot reciprocate? What if they are communicating to us all the time and we don't have the vision to see or the skill to hear their wisdom? I realize that some of you might think that I've gone off the deep end here. And then there's others of you that are worried that you won't be able to eat a carrot ever again for fear that they are crying in pain as you crunch down on them. I can tell you that what I understand of plants and animals is that they do understand their place in existence, in the web of existence. It's only humans that are lagging in that knowledge. A carrot or a mushroom knows its purpose is to provide nourishment to the bodies who grow and eat them. It is their purpose and their pleasure to be eaten. Indigenous people across the world have this knowledge. This is why they thank with reverence each mushroom and each animal that provides sustenance and medicine. Whether from the Amazon or the Canadian prairies or Japan, Indigenous people live from the knowledge that all nature is alive with purpose in an interdependent world. Shinto, or Shinto, is the indigenous religion of Japan. Although it is not a religion as we would understand religion in the West, it has no founder, no dogma, and no sacred text. Shinto is a way of life based on relationships of balance and harmony with a world considered sacred. It is a religion of the earth. Its holy places, its shrines, are places that are powerfully filled with the kami, or the spirits of nature. In Shinto, what matters is where you are and what you do there. I first became aware of Shinto when Stephen Epperson, who is the minister of the Unitarian minister of the Vancouver Church, returned from a trip to Japan, where he spent part of his first sabbatical learning about this earth-centered religion. I must admit that I rarely remember the content of a Sunday service a year later, let alone 20 years later. But I do remember the vivid story that Stephen told about his visit to the waterfall at the Tsubaki Shrine, which is in the midst of the sacred forest at the foot of Mount Udo in central Japan. I do not have his account today, but because the Unitarian Universalist Association has a scholarship that sends student ministers to Japan to experience the Shinto religion, I've been able to read many accounts of similar experiences, which I will pull together as if it were one person. First of all, a little context about Shinto. Author John Nelson describes the Shinto worldview as, quote, the actual phenomena of the world itself as being divine. The world itself is divine. And kami is at the center of this worldview. Kami veneration, or the respect for our relationship with nature, was practiced in Japan over 2,300 years ago, and well before Buddhism arrived. Now, kami doesn't have a good translation in English. It's not really a god. It's not really a spirit. It's not omnipotent, nor necessarily immortal. 18th century Japanese scholar Matori Noragada described the kami as, quote, anything which can inspire in us a sense of wonder and awe. We might say that that is the one word incarnation of the first source of Unitarian Universalism. Quote, direct experience of the transcending mystery and wonder affirmed in all cultures that moves us to a renewal of the spirit and an openness to the forces which create and uphold life. Kami. Kami is also the first word in the Japanese writing of Shinto, which translates to the way of the kami. Shinto then is the way of wonder and awe. The way of wonder and awe. So think sunsets and flowering orchids. Think also, though, of earthquakes and volcanoes, droughts, and plagues. kami can be both positive and negative, but always it elicits that sense of wonder and awe. Thank you, Ruth. Kami are encountered everywhere, but especially in shrines. There are thousands of public shrines in Japan dedicated to a specific kami. They can be at a mountain or a volcano or a distinctive tree or a waterfall. The places themselves hold the kami. When one visits a shrine, one is going there to meet the kami, to encounter the kami of the place. There is ritual involved in the process of this encounter. The shrines are marked with gates, like this one. The gate, or tori, is often at the entrance to the shrine, but it can also be within the shrine. The gate marks the transition from the mundane world to the spiritual world. Walking through the gate, you walk into the spiritual world of kami, where all is alive. Every stone, every leaf, every cloud, where even the air you breathe is alive with kami. If you approach the kami of the waterfall, one hears the roar of the kami's voice as it falls from high above, splashing on rock after rock, its spray flinging out into the sunlight, filling your breath with its wetness. There are handholds where you need them and steps in the rocks. It is under the waterfall that one of the central rituals of Shinto takes place. Misogi is more than a ritual of purification. It is about preparing oneself to be purified. It is about creating consciously one's alignment of body, thought, and spirit with the kami of the waterfall. The waterfall is the home of the kami called Saru Tahiko, the great spirit, to whom the shrine is dedicated. Saru Tahiko is the most powerful of the earthly kamis, the waterfall whose water comes from above on the sacred mountain is his home. As such, we have to purify ourselves before we enter the waterfall. The process is a sacred process. Excuse me. There are right things to wear. A loincloth for men, a simple robe for women, and headbands for both with a sacred symbol on them. A prayer of purification is conducted, and a series of physical exercises are performed, inviting energy into our bodies and cutting away our impurities. A priest performs a ritual and prayer, and then purifies the water with salt and sake by mixing them and then spitting the mixture, spewing it across the water. After this purification, we can enter the waterfall for the first time. I want you to imagine the roar of the waterfall falling on you. Imagine the physical sensation of thousands of pounds of water pounding down on your body. How your legs have to brace against the pressure just to keep you standing. Your whole body instantly, intensely feeling the freezing water all around you. The power of the kami around and within you. As one person described it, there was no room in my head for thought. There was no past, no future. I was forcefully present to the intensity of the kami. we will enter the waterfall three times. Standing under the power of the water, we pray by forming a sword, using the first two fingers of the right hand, extending our arms, and then forcefully cutting through the air while yelling out, Hare, Tame, Kayomi, Tame, Rokono Shoujo. Roughly translated, purify my soul, wash my soul. We yell it over and over and over again, forcing the words to leave our mouths, forcing the words through the power of the falling kami. Stepping out from the rushing waterfall is almost a letdown. We bow and clap to the waterfall, then bow to the shrine, and it is done. It is impossible to not be renewed by this ritual. Our past impurities, gone. We have let go regrets, shame, guilt, our fears and worries. The energy of nature has washed through us, and we are ready to start fresh. Such is the power of the waterfall kami. A Shinto priest who has dedicated his life to showing people the power of the waterfall kami said he does it because many Japanese people are no longer religious, and that he hopes the waterfall experience will have them re-examine their spirituality. Is this not what is needed most in our lives? A re-examination of what our spirituality means to us, so that our spirituality is in alignment with the world we live in. And I mean the natural world. A world that we think awesome and filled with wonder, but that we hesitate to really engage with. Hesitate to enter into real and meaningful relationships with. After her experience at the Tsubaki Grand Shrine, Barbara Prose summed up her experience with this question. How do I understand the fact that the world I see is now more ravishingly beautiful, and that I did not see this beauty before? How do I understand the fact that the world I see is now more ravishingly beautiful, and that I did not see this beauty before? There are many different ways to actively engage with this living world. There are many different ways to be in relationship with it. We can listen to carrots, orchids, and trees. We can encounter waterfalls and forests. We can listen to what they're saying on equal footing. Each is part of the earth, as are we, as are we. Go deeper, says the brilliant mycelium. Go deeper. Have you vision? Are you listening? Can you feel us? Share our wisdom. May it be so. And thank you for listening.
Thank you, Debra. Please join in our second song, Turn the World Around, and thank you again to Ruth for putting our words up on the screen. We come from the fire, living in the fire. Go back to the fire, turn the world around. We come from the water, living in the water. Go back to the water, turn the world around. We come from the mountain, living on the mountain. Go back to the mountain, turn the world around.
We welcome your donations and pledges in two different ways. First, we have set up the Unitarian Fellowship bank account to automatically deposit e-transfers sent to info@ufon.ca. Secondly, you can write a check and pop it in the mail. Our charity for April through June is Nanaimo Samaritan House. Samaritan House provides four services to women in crisis: emergency shelter, supportive housing, transitional housing, and rent subsidies. Their staff are dedicated to creating a safe, warm, welcoming environment and to provide emotional support and empathy at an extremely vulnerable time for women that come to their doors. If you would like to donate to the designated charity for the month, Nanaimo Samaritan House, please note that on your e-transfer or check. We are grateful for your offering. And now, our closing words. This is written by Margaret Keep. As surely as we belong to the universe, we belong together. We join here to transcend the isolated self, to reconnect, to know ourselves to be at home, here on Earth, under the stars, linked with each other. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
And now you're all invited to switch to gallery view and imagine we're all in a big circle holding hands, and we will sing our closing song together, carry the flame of peace and love until we meet again. Then we shall see a world of light and a world of joy. Carry the flame of peace and love until